wish was there.
She is delivered in Jesus' name.
Thank you, Jesus. I'm free. Thank you, Jesus.
Vous avez vu comment Dieu a délivré cette personne après la parole de prophétie. L'homme de Dieu a prié pour elle. Elle fut délivrée de la puissance du Saint-Esprit. Et dans quelques instants, elle est au milieu de nous pour partager ce témoignage de ce que Dieu a fait dans sa vie. Lorsque Dieu parle, la solution arrive. Écoutez et que Dieu vous bénisse.
Ahora vamos a escuchar ese maravilloso testimonio de cómo una palabra profética entregada por el profeta T.B. Joshua liberó a esta mujer del espíritu que la hacía orinarse en la cama y además tener un sangrado.
Once again, let's clap for wonderful Jesus Christ. So that is sister in question. Right now, we're about to listen to her wonderful testimony. And God bless you as you listen in Jesus' name. As tell us your name and where you come from.
Emmanuel, my name is Miss Success Joseph. I'm from Edo State. I'm 22 years old. The prophecy that man of God prophesied last week Sunday is true. I confirm it to be true. I was the girl that man of God prophesied to that was bedwetting and see blood. I was the girl that man of God prophesied to that was bedwetting and seeing blood. The next person is my mother.
Okay, tell us how you can confirm this message of prophecy to be true for your life.
This day started when I was 9 years old. The spirit of bedwetting started when I was 9 years old, when I lost my father. From that time, I've never go to visit any of my family members or go to visit friends or go out. I always live with my mother. It's my mother that used to wash my clothes when I bedwet when I was very young. So then when I grew up a little bit, so she said she don't have money to take up my junior ones. It's just only my junior one, but for my school fees, she don't have any more. That I have to go and learn work, I should go and stay with her sister. So she talked to her sister that, you know my church problem, so you can be able to take off her from me. So you can be able to take off her from me. So this is how I went to stay with my auntie. I lived with her. I was learning the stylist before I met a lady that came to tell me that if she takes me to Europe, my problem is going to be solved. So through then, my mom was not aware. My auntie I was even living with was not aware of my traveling. This is how I left my auntie's house and traveled. I left Benin down to Kano. From Kano, that's how I went to Libya. So during the journey was not that easy. Even at the desert, many people died at the sea. The first time I entered the sea, I boat capsized. It was the grace of God I came outside as a living testimony to do. So finally, I took the last boat. I arrived in Italy.
If you may understand what you're saying. You said you came to the Synagogue Church of One Nation last Sunday and there was a message of prophecy. There is a lady here that had been bedwetting as well as seeing blood. And you came out to confirm this message of prophecy. And you said this issue of bedwetting is true in your life. It started at the age of 9 when your father died. You started bedwetting and it was so serious that your mother was the one helping you to wash your clothes each time you wet the bed. And you got to a stage whereby your mom asked you to go and live with one of her sisters because she could not afford taking care of you. For you to go and learn something to do, and you went there and the issue of bedwetting started. Could you tell us how this bedwetting affected your life generally, even with your mother's sister?
It was really terrible. Every time I feel sad, I don't feel happy because people always laugh at me and make jest of me that look at me, I'm beautiful, look at the problem I'm carrying.
Okay, now from there you said you made a journey to where?
I made a journey down to Libya before I get to Italy. So the journey was really terrible. It was not that too easy. So my journey to Libya down to Italy was really not that too easy. So when I arrived in Italy, the woman that came to my shop when I was learning the work that told me that he can help me. So a sister came to take me out of the camp. So when I get there, she told me that she's not here to treat me. I'm here to pay her amount that she used to bring me down from Nigeria to Europe through prostitution. And then I don't know man, so she have to bring a man to the house to be making sex with me for 3 days. So that then when the man said I'm okay to go, that is how the prostitution started. I started working for her. She told me to give her 45,000 euro, but I could not be able to pay that money. I was only able to pay 70,800 euro. In a day, I used to meet like that kind of 20 men or 25, because she told me in a day I should be giving her 500 euro in a day. So if I did not meet up with that money, she would beat me and give me mank all over my body and have pepper to eat. Even at that process of me working to give her money, my womb fell several times. And they have those ladies, that those women, that those, she's a Benin woman, she learned a nurse in Nigeria before she go there. So she was the one that anything like abortion or womb problem, she's the one that came there to come and treat the girls. So before, I thank God for my life that I did not live with her, because I was feeling several pains every day. I always cry because my mother is not there. The reason why I even went there, the purpose is not solved.
Okay, you said you finally became a prostitute in Italy, and in a day you meet up to 20 to 25 men, so that you could get enough money to pay back to the woman who sponsored you. Now, can you tell us, was there any time you received a phone call from your mother, and what did you tell your mother you were doing there?
At that time, I don't ever have phone to call my mother. I'm not allowed to call my family at that time. So my parents don't know my whereabouts. They don't even know where I am at that time, if I'm still alive or dead.
Okay, now tell us, how do you finally make your way to Nigeria and finally to the Synagogue Church of All Nations?
Finally, did I make my way to Nigeria? Was one day when I was in the train, so I was feeling peace. Coming back from work in the morning, early morning, I was feeling peace. I was sitting there in the train crying. So a Senegal guy came to meet me in the train and tell me that he saw me, you know, that his patron that bring me down to Europe. And before then, she took some items for me, like my hair from my armpit and my fingernails, and told me that anytime I say any word out to the police or anyone, immediately I'm going to die. So I told the boy, I didn't say anything. Nobody bring me to Europe. I came on my own. He said, what is my problem? I did tell him. So he threatened me with police that if I did follow him, he's going to take me to the police, that he's going to arrest my patron. So I have to follow the boy. That is why I followed him down to his house. So getting to his house, he bring out Bible and Quran. He said, am I a Christian? I'm a Muslim. I said, I'm a Christian. So that is why he gave me Bible, and he gave me the olive oil for me to take. So since that time, I did not go to, break my SIM card that was used, that she gave to me, that she can be able to be contacting me. So he broke the SIM card that was leaving, that was not retired. That was the time I have to call my mother. I told my mother that I was going to school. She said, yeah. How did I get there? I said, it's a long story. She forgets about it, but now I'm fine. I'm going to school.
Okay, while you were there, you told your mom you were going to school.
Yeah. Yes.
Were you really going to school?
Yes, but at the first time, which I have not heard from, I was not going to school. But when I was with the guy, I was going to school.
Okay, how do you finally make your way to Nigeria?
When I went to the custodian to take my document is out. Getting there, that is how I met myself in deporting camp. From deporting camp, that is how I met myself in Nigeria. Then when I get to Nigeria, I called my mom that I'm in Nigeria. This is how she brings me to Synagogue Church of All Nations.
Okay, what happened last Sunday when you were here?
Last Sunday, the man of God in the mass prayer said that there is a lady here that is bedridden and seeing blood. This is how I came outside.
What happened last Sunday when you came outside? What happened?
I came outside to confirm the prophecy that is true. So since that day, I've not seen anything like, I've not bed weight or seen blood.
Okay, you mean after your deliverance, you no longer bed weight?
No.
And you no longer see blood?
No.
What about the urge of meeting men?
No, I don't have it anymore.
Shall we clap for wonderful Jesus Christ? Okay, let's hear from your mom.
Emmanuel. My name is Doris Egage Joseph. This is my daughter. So I've been looking for my daughter for more than 5 years now. So after I finish her secondary school, I don't have money to send her to school.
We know it's indeed a pathetic case, but we thank God for her deliverance. Now tell us, starting from the point of the issue of bedwetting. She said she was bedwetting and she was brought up by the message of prophecy, which is confirmed, and she was delivered. Let's pick the story from there. As a mother, what can you say about that?
It's true. After her father died, from there the bedwetting started. I tried my best, but my best is not good enough. I take it to my sister in Ondo State. We tried many herbalists to stop it. There is no way. So after then, I come back to village. After I come back to village, I now call her and sit down. I said, I can't continue your education now. She go and learn work to support me to train your younger one. He agreed with me. And I left the village to city to come and meet my sister, priest with my sister, to allow her to stay with him. He said, what about a bed? I said, don't worry, I will find, we buy another bed for you. He don't agree with me. So I now take my daughter from the village to go and give it to my sister. After 1 year, sometime we come to the village by weekend to come and take food stuff. So after about 6 months there, I don't hear from me, I don't hear from my sister. So I now left the village to come and see them. Immediately I get there, more than 1 hour, I now ask my sister, where is my daughter? He say, it's not at all. Small time, I now ask her again, this after 6, my daughter is not yet back. He say, no. After then, your husband came out from outside. I said, and after I greet her husband, I say, where is my daughter? He said, your sister has never tell you what your daughter did. I say, no. He said, your daughter live at home since 6 months now. I'm not shocked. I say, my daughter that I give to my sister that I trust so much. From there, now turn to quarrel. From there, we now drive body to police station. And I told the policeman that he used my daughter for ritual.
Okay.
So they now arrest my sister.
Let's briefly make it clear to us. It's a pathetic case. You can see her shedding tears. It's not easy for a woman who actually nurtured her baby from little level to this adolescent stage, finding her in this kind of condition. It's indeed a pathetic case. So she said she's indeed the mother of this young lady who had just shared her life experiences. It all started after the death of her husband, and when the daughter was precisely 9 years old was when the bedwetting started. It was so serious. And along the line, being a single parent, was not easy for her to cater for her and the other children. That was how she took her to her sister's house so that sister could also help in catering for her education. Along the line, after 1 year, she went to the sister without knowing that her daughter has absconded from the sister's house. So when she got there, the sister was not actually opening up to her, letting her know that for the past 6 months, they themselves have been looking for her, or to know have been locating where she was. It was then someone told her that your sister could have narrated the story of what your daughter did. For the past 6 months, she had left the house. Nobody knew where she was. And that was how she took her sister's case to the police station and reported the sister that her sister has used her daughter for money ritual.
So after that, about 2 years later, I now received a call from one man in my village. He said, somebody wants to speak with you. I said, I don't have anybody. He said, receive the call first. After I picked the call, I hear my daughter's voice. Where are you? He said, mommy, I'm in a foreign land. I said, foreign land? Who brought you to that? I don't have anybody there. What are you doing there? Because my brother always said that if they take a young girl from Nigeria to that side, they are using them for prostitute. He said, no, mommy, I'm not doing prostitute. I'm a student. I said, are you sure? He said, okay. Are you sure? He said, okay. He now called the phone off. After about 3 months, they now called a girl. I was not at home. I'm inside the farm. The man now brought the phone to come and give me. After I speak with him, I said, I want to get your number. He said, don't worry, the man will give you my number. The man now writes the number I give to me. About 2 weeks from there, I now come to the city. There is one of my cousins that teach in Uniben. I now give her the number. I say, please help me confirm whether my daughter is going to school or is not going to school. So after 2 days, I'm not going to meet the man in the office. He said I should calm down and say everything is all right. My daughter is going to school. As you see it in computer, he sent everything to him. Inside me, I was so happy. And I go back to the village. Sometimes if I call him, he say, Mommy, don't disturb me now. I'm in study, no. I will call the phone off. So that very day, that was wash night of New Year. He now called me, wish me happy New Year, wish younger one happy New Year. He now told me that, Mommy, don't worry. Very soon your problem will solve. I will remove you from the city, from village to the city. I will open a business for you. I will be cater for my younger one. That time you will have a rest of mind. And I pray for him. 30 minutes there, Mommy, pray for me. Mommy, pray for me. I say, which can prayer again? Which prayer? He said, pray for me. Pray for me. I say, where? Where am I going to? Is it left or right? Am I going to start the prayer? He said, police is here. Police want to arrest me. I say, ha. He been in there. Does he arrest student? Oh? Do you steal? He say, no. Do you kill somebody? He say, no. I say, hey, what do you do now? The next thing, I call the phone off. After about 4 days, they now call me with one number. And I pick the call. I don't even know. I saw his name. He say, ooh, princess. Ooh. Where are you? I said, this is my dinner number. He say, I'm in Lagos. I don't even have transport. I say, Lagos again? He said, I don't have transport to come back home. I said, don't worry, I will come to Lagos to come and see you. Because after that, when I was looking for him for all those years, I come to this synagogue to say, God, help me locate my daughter. So immediately I came to Lagos on Saturday. He said, let us go back. I said, no, this is the same church I come before you refuse to call me, before I hear from you and me. I said, we'll still come to the same church to come and thank God before you will go back to Benin. That is how we come to church. That very day.
So before you continue with your story, I want to just ask you a question, Ma. You said when you finally spoke to your daughter, she told you she was in a foreign land, and you asked her what she was doing there. She said she was schooling, and that very soon she will become a graduate. And she will take you from the village to the city. How do you feel when she was telling you that?
I was so happy. I saw all my sorrow has ended.
Then you believe that your daughter was indeed schooling?
Yes.
Okay, now what have you heard from her?
I don't ever hear anything.
What do you hear from her now?
I was so surprised. I'm short of words. I don't know what to say no more. Eh? He said that he's doing prostitution on that side. I was short of words. I don't even know how I get to that place. I don't know. This okay. Is my first time.
This is your first time of hearing that?
Yes.
That she was not schooling?
Yes.
She was doing prostitution?
Yes.
There.
Since last week, I asked him, I said, what are you doing there? Tell me the truth. I'm your mother. I said, Mommy, don't worry. By the time we get to Benin, I will tell you.
So you're hearing for the first time?
For my first time now.
Okay, now tell us, as you said earlier on, that when you were looking for her, you came to the Synagogue Church of Four Nations to pray so that God could bring her home safely. And she finally came home. You are the same person who brought her last Sunday to the Synagogue Church of Four Nations. What happened last Sunday that brought about this testimony?
After a man of God measured her case, he said he will not come outside. I said, when man of God measured her case, that there is one lady here that bed wet. After he bed wet, we see blood. It's true. If he bed wet, blood will be rushing. So when man of God measure her case, I say, come outside. He say, no, he say, he will not come outside. I'll not push it outside before Usher come and take it from me.
Let's clap for wonderful Jesus Christ. This really proves that she's indeed a good mother. She really wanted the goodness of her daughter, and she continued pressing on until she brought her to the point of her deliverance. And now, after she came out to confirm the message of prophecy last Sunday, and she was touched by the man of God, and the evil spirit in her that caused her bedwetting and seeing blood actually manifested and was cast out last week. What are the changes you have seen in your daughter?
Many changes. Before I say one, before it will tell me 100. But now, if I say one, it will come down. Bedwetting has stopped. And stop. Bed wetting and stop. The blood and stop.
And we thank God Almighty for what He has done in the life of your daughter and also in your own life. Because in as much as your daughter is free, you are free as well. Now tell us, as a mother, what words of advice do you have for parents and for everyone listening to you?
The advice I have for children, please, I'm begging you in the name of God, listen to your parents very well. You mother, train your children in the way of God, so therefore we have the fear of God.
Thank you very much. Let's hear a word of advice from your daughter.
My advice goes to the youth like me. It's not everybody that say that is taking you to Europe. They are going for good. They are all going for prostitution. Even the men there. So I need to advise everybody, the young that is growing up, that is planning to go to that. There's no work there for the boys or the girls. Whether the boys are begging or the girls are doing prostitution.
You heard it all from her. That look before you leap and wait for God's appointed time. Because God's time is the best. And we thank God Almighty for what He has done in your life and for the entire family. And we pray as you go and make the word of God a standard for your life, we pray that your miracle and your deliverance remain permanent in Jesus' name. Shall we put our hands together beautifully for the miracle working God?
Escuchamos ese maravilloso testimonio de esta joven que atravesó por una dolorosa situación debido a espíritus malignos que la llevaron a la prostitución. Ella vino aquí y recibió una profecía que había una mujer que estaba orinándose en la cama y además estaba sangrando. Ella salió al frente y confirmó aquella profecía y nos cuenta que todo empezó cuando ella tenía 9 años, que inició a orinarse, empezó a orinarse en la cama. Dice que después de que su padre falleciera y debido a la terrible condición económica, su madre decidió enviarla a vivir con su hermana a otra ciudad para que pudieran ayudarle con su educación. Lamentablemente, cuando ella estaba con su hermana, vino una mujer y le ofreció viajar al extranjero para supuestamente darle un mejor futuro. Ella, sin saberlo, la estaban llevando para tráfico humano. Dice que después de un terrible viaje que pasó por Libia, finalmente llegó a Italia y ahí aquella mujer la sometió a la prostitución, además de diferentes rituales de brujería y hechicería para supuestamente mejorar en su trabajo. Pero dice que pasó por cosas terribles, durmiendo entre 20 y 25 hombres por día con tan solo 20 años de edad. Ella dice que esta mujer, si ella no cumplía con esta meta diaria, la golpeaba, la lastimaba y la amenazaba. Para la gloria de Dios, ella cuenta que además de diferentes situaciones, ella llegó finalmente a un campo de refugiados donde ella fue finalmente deportada de regreso a Nigeria. Dice que ahí contactó a su madre después de muchos años de no tener contacto con ella y decidieron venir a la SCOAN. Dice que estando aquí, después de la palabra profética, recibió oración por parte del hombre de Dios, el profeta T.D. Joshua, y el espíritu inmundo detrás de su situación se manifestó y fue echado fuera en el nombre de Jesús. Hoy está aquí con su madre para testificar que el orinarse en la cama ya se detuvo, ya no está sangrando y además ha sido libre de ese espíritu de prostitución, y aconseja a todos los jóvenes que no piensen en ir al extranjero porque pueden ser presa fácil para el tráfico humano y la prostitución. Y su madre también ruega a los jóvenes que escuchen el consejo de los padres para no caer en las garras de Satanás en estas situaciones. Hoy le da la gloria a Jesucristo porque ya es libre.
Nous avons entendu le témoignage de cette jeune femme qui s'appelle Joseph. Elle nous a dit, raconte son histoire, comment elle s'est trouvée dans la prostitution. Quand elle est venue, l'homme de Dieu a donné une parole de prophétie. Il y a une femme ici qui fait pipi au lit et qui saigne en même temps. Et lorsqu'elle est venue pour confirmer la prophétie, que c'était vrai, elle a raconté que dès l'âge de 9 ans, elle a commencé à faire pipi au lit et avoir des pertes de sang. Alors, elle raconte comment, étant jeune, elle a perdu son père, alors elle a commencé à faire pipi au lit, et sa mère, qui n'avait pas les moyens de subsistance pour l'éduquer, l'a donné à sa sœur pour l'aider à l'élever. Donc, quand elle était chez sa sœur, un jour, une femme est venue, lui propose une solution qui va l'envoyer quelque part où ses problèmes seraient terminés. Elle a cru, et c'est là qu'elle s'est retrouvée dans un voyage extrêmement dangereux vers la Libye, vers l'Europe, à travers le désert. Elle s'est retrouvée en Libye, et ils ont essayé de traverser la Méditerranée avec les bateaux. La première fois, ça s'est échoué, le bateau a coulé, et Dieu l'a miraculeusement sauvée. La troisième tentative est la bonne, elle a été secourue et s'est retrouvée dans un camp de réfugiés en Italie. Elle dit, un jour, dans le camp des réfugiés, une femme est venue la faire sortir. Et lorsqu'elle est sortie, elle a conduit dans un autre lieu. Elle pensait être sauvée, mais c'était l'enfer qui commençait. Cette femme l'a conduit dans un lieu où elle devait faire la prostitution. Un homme a commencé à la violer. Et depuis ce jour-là, la femme l'a menacée qu'il doit amener 500 euros par jour. Elle s'est forcée à faire la prostitution jusqu'à 25 hommes par jour. La souffrance était terrible jusqu'à ce que ses entrailles en furent affectées. C'est dans une souffrance telle qu'un jour, elle est sortie, un homme l'a rencontrée et cet homme lui a proposé de l'aider. Il l'a amenée chez lui, il a commencé à l'aider. C'est là qu'elle s'est retrouvée par la grâce de Dieu à avoir un travail, à étudier. Et tout d'un coup, la police l'a arrêtée par une main divine. Sa mère, en ce temps-là, cherchait sa fille, ne savait pas où elle était. Elle s'est rendue vers sa sœur. Sa sœur lui a dit qu'elle était sans nouvelles. Il lui dit, comment ça se fait que tu es sans nouvelles? Et le mari lui a dit, mais ta fille ne t'a pas dit ce qui est arrivé? Ta fille est partie. Elle est partie en Europe. La mère, pendant 5 ans, n'avait pas de nouvelles de sa fille. C'est ainsi qu'un jour, lorsqu'elle a rencontré cet homme qui l'a proposé de secours en Italie, elle a appelé sa mère pour la première fois depuis 5 ans. Et sa mère a appris que sa fille était vivante et lui a dit qu'elle étudiait, alors que c'était le contraire qui s'est passé. Dans les prières, Dieu l'a sauvée de cette vie de prostitution. Un jour, la police l'a arrêtée. C'est ainsi qu'elle s'est fait expulser vers le Nigeria. Et lorsqu'elle est arrivée, elle est venue directement ici à l'église. Et c'est là que la parole de prophétie est venue pour révéler le problème qui était dans sa vie. Dieu l'a délivrée, Dieu l'a sauvée, Dieu l'a guérie. Elle a réconcilié la famille et lui donne un avenir meilleur. Le conseil qu'il donne à tous les jeunes, n'allez pas là-bas. Si vous allez là-bas, il n'y a pas de travail. Le seul travail, c'est la prostitution. Attendez le temps de Dieu. La mère donne conseil à toutes les mères d'être patientes, de ne pas livrer leurs enfants à ce voyage dangereux et de s'attendre à Dieu, car le temps de Dieu, c'est le meilleur. Que Dieu vous bénisse.
Imagine spirits of stealing, and to the man he thought he was doing it then for fun, never knew that he was bringing a curse to his family and to his generation, if not for God's intervention. Many people are seated today, you don't know the reason why you are facing the problem you are facing as a son, as a daughter. You don't know what your father must have done, or what your mother must have done in the past, or what your great-grandfather must have done. It takes God Almighty, Jesus Christ himself, to put an end to such problems. The Bible says Jesus Christ comes into our lives to put an end to our past and give birth to our future. The reason why God has given his able servant, senior prophet T.B. Joshua, this power of prophecy is to reveal those things we must have done, we have forgotten, that are the genesis and the root causes of our problems. When they are revealed, they are actually put to an end because God reveals to redeem. And when such cases are put to an end, as a family, deliverance will come to pass in your lives. And of course, you start living your life anew again. You can look at the case of the sister who traveled abroad with the aim of going for greener pastures without knowing that she was going there for prostitution. The question you need to ask yourself as a mother, as a father who have children who are living abroad, what are they doing there? Are they still alive? These are questions you need to ask yourself. Only God can tell you the heart of man. So we are bringing these testimonies to your view for you to listen to them attentively, ponder over them, relate them to your family as well. Because any moment from now, what you witness the life of these people will happen live and direct. The moment his able servant, senior prophet T.B. Joshua, comes to your midst. That's why we're bringing this testimony to your view for you to watch and get prepared today for the Lord's attention. And God bless you as you do so in Jesus' name.
Praise the Lord. ceremony, and before the family come out, we are going to watch the screen of our television and see how this all began through the prophecy, word of prophecy of the anointed man of God. So watch your screen.
Ahora mismo observe su pantalla el video de la liberación y de la palabra profética que el hombre de Dios dio a esta familia que ha traído restauración. Observe su pantalla.
Nous allons maintenant regarder une vidéo où l'homme de Dieu a profité dans leur vie pour exposer la racine du problème. Regardons notre écran maintenant.
There is a brother there. You are about to marry your housemate. That is the cause of trouble in the house, and you don't know how to go about it. Suddenly, you just find yourself like that. Very difficult to explain. So please, your housemate, your wife left everything, everybody say no, 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 but you can't listen well until you decided now. This will lead us to call your wife, to call your family, bring not only getting you delivered, because what is happening to you is purely demon. So please come, come, come. Thank you for coming here today.
My name is Chief Oladile Ogundele. I'm the one that sleeps with outside.
Brother, don't worry. Come on. Ordinarily, you will never do that. There's an attack, very serious attack, and that has destroyed your house.
Yes, sir.
And what a house you build. What a wonderful family. It is evil spirits, and for God to bring you here, well, God has put an end to that. I'm going to see you, and we bring the family together, you receive your deliverance. Don't worry, I don't want you to talk here. So it's a very painful issue.
Este es un testimonio de cómo una palabra profética ha liberado y ha reconciliado a toda una familia. Así que sean bendecidos mientras escuchan este maravilloso testimonio.
Nous allons maintenant écouter le témoignage de la réconciliation à travers de la prophétie de l'homme de Dieu, où l'homme de Dieu a vu que voilà, il y avait des problèmes, des troubles de sommeil. Nous allons maintenant écouter la suite. Restez connectés pour la suite.
To God be the glory. That was the message of prophecy that the man received when he came to the church last service day, and he is here today, and we want to listen to him. And before he continues with his testimony, he would. So we welcome you once again to the Synagogue Church in Jesus' name. Can you please introduce yourself and those who have come with you today before you tell us your testimony?
My name is Chief Oladile Ogundele. I'm from Kwara State. I reside in Abuja. The woman beside me here, she's Mr. Ogundele. And the other boy is Samuel Ogundele, my first son. And which the other boy is Bolu Ogundele. 2 weeks ago, man of God prophesied on me that there's somebody sleep with a house help, which is true, it's me. Before I leave Abuja, Lagos, I stayed in Abuja, in Lagos before, me and my woman. My first wife.
Okay, so we want you to calm down and be able to explain yourself, because people are learning from your experience. Okay, so now tell us how it all began. Mm-hmm. Before you left Lagos for Abuja, what happened?
I left them 13 years ago, before I left Lagos. I went to Abuja. I'm aluminium fabricator. There's not too much job. So I used to go to Abuja to go and look for a job, which I spent almost 2 weeks there. When I come back, I have some money with me, very close to my house. Someone now said that I should come. I went there. I see my friend, all of them, they are drinking, and I joined them. When I joined them, and I said that they should take round. I give them round. Someone now called me. Do you want to buy for this boy? I say yes. He said, ah, this guy has slept with my wife. I said, no, it can't be possible. But suddenly I drink. I left the place. From there, I went home. I called my wife. What happened? She denied. But later she told me the truth.
Okay, so.
Which I left home for 13 years ago. I've traveled to Abuja to go and start another life there.
Okay, once again, tell us, for how many years now you've left home after you had this misunderstanding with your wife?
It's 12 years, 13 years ago.
So from then on, what happened when you left Lagos? Where did you go to and what happened?
When I get to Abuja, I start another life there, looking for work, and things is not moving the way I want. So there's one church that I went to, and I met one lady there, and we met in the church. When I met the girl in the church, and in Abuja, where they do deliverance. So they said that we should go for the evangelism. They line a man like this and a woman like this, and they pick each one so that one man and one woman for the evangelism.
And you said that was your first time in the church? First time in the...
First time to go to that church, yes. So from there, we started dating ourselves. After then,
praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Please let us listen, because we have a lot of lessons to learn. Amen. Let us listen. Thank you.
So we started dating ourselves. Suddenly, she says she's pregnant. Along the line, there's nothing I can do because I sleep inside the shop where I'm working in Garki. Which I told him. I told her. So later, the girl now said that we should come and see in family. Which I went there. When we get there, Nabi is somebody that I normally see in the screen, the former minister. I look at him because I was surprised, because she told me in the church that doesn't have anybody, that it's only her. Even when I get to where he's staying, it's just only chair and bed. He just put it there, but he rents a good apartment there.
So you were surprised when you went home to her parents and you discovered that her father was a former minister in this country?
Yes.
Right?
Yes. So suddenly she just come to my where I'm working in Garki, and she give me she just brought a motor car. Where did you see the car? She said he doesn't have anybody. She said that she keep it with her pastor. The pastor said that you should keep it. I mean, you should keep the car until when he gets married. So she gave me the car, because I know how to drive the car. We started cruising. From there, we now went to go and see the family. When we get to the family, and the family said that, okay, this is your husband, and they give us money, 1 million naira, that we should start our life, that we should go to my family and our own family to prepare for the wedding. So after then, we do the wedding. When we finish the wedding, we are together. She now said that she need a house help, that I should give her one. She need a house help, which I went to one village like that. So I brought the house help to the house. When I brought the girl to the house, after 2 months, the girl said that she want to leave. I said, no, don't leave, please. still stay because I'm the one that bred the girl. Later, I started sleeping with the girl.
And you mean when you started sleeping with who? Which girl are you talking about?
The housemate.
And your wife was not aware. The second wife was not aware.
No. The only thing the guest told me that I should promise her marriage because it's. He said, "I should promise her marriage."
You mean the house help?
The house help, yes.
When you slept with her, told you to promise her that you are going to marry her.
Yes, that I'm going to marry her. But I know that I cannot marry her because she's a small.
But did you promise?
Yes, I promise. I promised the house help that I'm going to marry her because. I promise her that I want to marry her. So later, they are doing one festival. The girl left our house. She's not more staying in our house again. Suddenly, when the problem started coming in the house, I look at it maybe because of what the promise that I promised the girl. That is why I cannot be able to. I mean, the thing is rough again. I cannot be able to even see my woman face again in the house.
So you mean you started having problem with your second wife now?
Yes. So one day I was in the house. My wife now called me that I should take out the baby, that she's going to somewhere that is coming now.
So by this time she already has a baby for you?
Yes, I already have the baby for me.
Okay.
So now I'm taking out the baby, a buffer, and giving schizo cream to eat so that I can be able to take it to school. I just hear the cock of the gun. My wife said that, hold it very well.
Okay, can you tell us what happened before then? Where did your wife go and what happened while you were taking care of the baby?
No, she just went to police station to go and bring three police to my house. So the next thing that I hear, I just hear the cock of gun. Who is that? My wife opened the door and said that they should owe me very well, that I have I can disappear. That is my second wife. So he said I can disappear, that they should owe me very well. I say, okay, I don't have anything. I'm saying, what is the problem? She didn't tell me anything until when I get to police station. But when I get to police station, they just put me inside the cell. Nothing like written. I didn't write anything. They just take me inside the cell for 3 days. After 3 days, one man now come to the police station that they want to pray for us, and they bring me out. Then I say that, do I have family? I say, yes, I have family. And meanwhile, none of my family, they don't want that my woman, that my second woman. It's because she's older than me. They don't want her. So prior to this time,
did you have any serious misunderstanding, disagreement, or fight with her before she brought the policemen to arrest you and lock you up?
No, the only thing is that you say that I drink anytime that I used to drink.
That was all?
That was all, yeah.
Okay.
So she said that there's a goat in the house that I steal the goat, and which I don't know anything about this something.
So what happened when you got to the station after they lock you up? What happened?
When I get to the station, there's one pastor just pray, after prayer, the house, they said that's on my phone. I want my phone, and someone called me, which is one of my friends. They come to the police station to come and bail me. So from there, they said that I should write undertaking that if I see that woman in 20 meters, I'll still run another 20 meters, which I agree. And anytime I saw him, I will run. I will run. So that is how we separated since almost 12 years. That's 13 years ago now. I mean, 12 years ago now.
So what happened after that?
After that, thing is very rough. There's no work. I look for work anywhere. There's even when I even get work, there'll be a problem. To pay house rent is not easy. So I'm now trying to marry another, the third wife. So I said before I could even do anything, I have to come and pray. So,
okay, so you,
my girlfriend asked,
so you were, after your second wife left with your baby, you were in the process of marrying the third woman.
Yes.
And you thought this time around that you should come to this place, to the Synagogue Church of Foundation, to seek the face of God before you go into this third marriage, right?
Yes, sir.
Okay.
So when I get there, something just tell me that anywhere they ask me to sit down, I will sit. Even in the canopy, I will sit. Because the person that introduced this place to me said that whatever, anywhere they put me, I should just sit down there. So I was somewhere there. The man of God now prophesied on me that there's a man that sleep with a house help, which is me, true. Actually, if they say is this my woman here, I don't think I should forgive. I don't think I can. I will not come out. But I was somewhere there. So something just pushed me out. I don't even know when I'm out. Until when I'm.
Okay. What are you trying to say? You mean if the man of God has given a prophecy that day that there is a man here, you need to forgive a woman. You mean you would not have come out?
I don't think I will come out.
Okay. So, but because the man of God said there's a man here that slept with a housemaid, that's why you came out?
Yes, because I promised her that I want to marry her. Since that time, I didn't see the girl. So I believe that that girl is the one that's doing me.
So you believe that it was after sleeping with that housemaid, that was where your problem started?
Yes.
So that was the reason why you came out?
Yes.
So it means the Holy Spirit was so intelligent enough to have said something that will bring you out?
Yes.
Okay, so when you came here, what happened?
When I came here, and they told me that, where is my wife? I mean, the man of God said, where is my wife? My first wife. I shook it. I said, it's in Lagos here. They asked me, what's her name? I said, it's Miriam. He said, since last time that I saw them, say it has been long, but I used to, if I have any money, I send it to them. If she used her phone number to call me, I will not pick it. But if my son used her number, called me or text me, daddy is me, I will pick or I call them back. So since that time, I just abandoned them. And man of God tell me that I should just call them. That as look for some forever, as we go, I beg them that as we bring them here to come down to this place. That is why they are here now.
Okay. Well, let's clap for Jesus Christ. So you mean since that time, since how many years now you said this incident happened when you left your first wife?
13 years ago.
Since 13 years, you've abandoned her with the children?
Yes.
Okay. So, I think it's time we listen to the madam. Let her also share with us her own side of the story. We believe she also has something to say. So, madam, we welcome you to the Synagogue Church of All Nations today in Jesus' name. Can you please introduce yourself? And who's this man standing here? Who is he to you? And the two young men standing beside you.
Good morning. My name is Mary Ogundele. This is my children and my father of my children. So this is father of my children. Since 13 years ago now, we are not seeing him. Last week, it just came me that a man of God wants to see me.
Okay, before last week, can you share with us one or two experiences that you've had over these 13 years with him after he abandoned you and the children? Can you share with us one or two occasions or experience you've had?
Along the line, that time we went to Abuja and I take the two of them to Abuja to go and see him. And he chased me away that he didn't want to see me. So there, I don't know anybody from Abuja. So I look for money to come back for Lagos. And my parents were telling me that I should go and look for another man. So marriage, are we going to stay with this? Only me with two children, and their father is no more to see us. So that's, and last week he not told me that a man of God wants to see me. I was shocked that, more than 13 years. Okay. That's what I've come to.
And have you been to the Synagogue Church of All Nations here before?
No, I don't know here before.
This is your very first time?
This is my first time.
So when you heard the news that the church wanted to see you, how did you feel, and what was going through your mind?
I'm feeling, and I'm shocked. I'm not happy. That day when he called me that he want to see me, I'm not happy. What is happening? He said nothing. I should come. So I'm not following him.
So you are not happy because previously he doesn't attend to you, and when you call him, when each time you call him on the phone, what happened?
I'm shocked.
No, when you called him before last week, when you called him on the phone, can you give us an instance when you called him on the phone and how he reacted to you?
He will abuse me and he will cut my phone. So
that was why when he called you last week that your attention was needed in the church, you were not happy with him, right?
Yes.
Okay. So can we just hear a word from your son? Welcome, brother. Can you please introduce yourself?
Good morning to you all. My name is Samuel Ogundele.
And how old are you now?
I'm 15 years old.
Okay. And who is the woman standing beside you?
She's my mom. That is my brother. He's my dad.
So what can you tell us about all what we have heard from your dad and your mom?
When I was 2 years old, that time I was in Lagos here. I would see my mom, she would be shedding tears. I would tell her that, mommy don't cry. That time I don't know anything. I would tell her that, mommy don't cry, mommy, what happened? She would say that nothing. I would tell her that, mommy, what is the matter? She would say that, don't worry, my son. So when I was in school, she do take care of me. She will pay my school fees. And when anytime my friends, they will come with their dad, their mom, I will be saying that, I wish my dad is here. Then when I come back from school, I will tell my mom that, mommy, please, I want to see my daddy. He say that my daddy is not around, that he went out. And I say, where's my daddy? That I can't find my dad. You see that, don't worry, you will see your dad. For over now, I'm 15 years old now. And what I want God to do is that I want God to use Prophet TB Joshua to reconcile my dad and my mom.
Okay, can you tell us, you mean as at the time your father left your mom, how old was your younger brother?
My mom.
Was he born then?
She was pregnant that time.
Okay, your mom was pregnant of your younger brother?
Yes, sir.
When?
My dad left us.
Okay. Well, we have listened to you and we have listened to the man and the wife. So, sir, can you tell us, what do you want people to learn from the experience you have had so far? And now that God Almighty has revealed your case, what lesson do you want people to learn from you?
I know I offended my wife so much. I just want to I want her to forgive me. So just forgive me.
Okay, now people are listening to you, and you know, this was the first woman in your life. You left her with the children. You met another woman, left her with the children, with the child, or she left with your child, and you were preparing for the third woman when you came here. So, having gone through this, what advice do you have for people? Listen to you now.
People that you are looking to me now, the people that you are looking at me now, I know what I did is very wrong. Please, it's not good because I find it difficult to even take care of myself. Anybody that see me, they will think maybe I'm okay. But inside me, I know that I'm not okay because, and which the when I come here, it was when I know that this is the cause of my problem. So people, because.
Okay, I want you to explain better. It was when you came to the synagogue, Church of Four Nations, you, after receiving the prophecy from the man of God, you got to realize that your problem started where? Eh?
Yes, sir.
That what?
That until when I come to this place, I know that it's at least, see, because I left them, that is the cause of my problem.
Okay.
Anytime she called me now, I'm very so happy. In fact, this morning I called them 2 times in a day now.
Okay, would you, for any reason, advise any man to follow the footsteps you have taken in the past?
I just want to tell people, anybody that fall into this problem, you should just go and reconcile with his wife.
Okay, rather than looking for another.
Yeah, another one.
Eh?
Yes, sir.
Okay, thank you. So we would like to hear also a word of advice from Madam. Please, what do you want to share with people going by what you have experienced? So you mean since the past 13 years, your husband abandoned you and the children, you've not remarried?
No.
Huh?
No.
You have not remarried?
Yes.
So what do you want people to learn from this?
I learned many things. And I want to tell people that this situation, to put their mind to God, so God can do anything.
That's have you been praying to God for a day like this to come?
Yes.
Okay. Okay, madam, I think he saw Yoruba. Ọ̀rọ̀ ìyànjú ò lè fẹ́ gba àwọn èèyàn ṣé ẹ gbàgbọ́ pé irú ọjọ́ yìí lè wáyé kí lẹ fẹ́ sọ fún àwọn èèyàn kí lè ẹ̀kọ́ tí ẹ fẹ́ kí àwọn èèyàn kọ́ nípa nǹkan tó ti ṣẹlẹ̀ sí yín.
Nǹkan tó ṣẹlẹ̀ sí mi káwọn èèyàn máa ní sùúrù àti faradà so wọn ò mọ̀ pé irú ọjọ́ báyìí lè wáyé náà so.
Okay, we have heard it from the woman, and we asked her to speak in our local dialect that what does she have to say about what she has gone through, what lesson, and going by her experience. And she said she never expected that a day like this would come, though she has been praying, but that people should be patient and be prayerful when they find themselves in situations like this. So we thank God we have listened to the family, and like the man of God says, the right knowledge of God settles peace. So the end of the matter lies in the hand of God, and in his wisdom, he has solution to all problems. So we leave everything till when the anointed man of God, Prophet Yeshua, comes into our midst, and we believe God today, we shall know the mind of God concerning this family. Thank you.
Escuchamos esta conmovedora historia de este hombre que vino aquí a la semana.